It's good to have you here this morning. If you're a guest of ours, my name is Bill. I'm one of the pastors here at the church, one of the elders. I'm the preaching elder. On your way, and hopefully you're able to grab a worship guide that'll help you throughout the service. It has tear-outs inside, which a couple different ones. One of the tear-outs has the ongoing events that we have and announcements. Some of the other tear-outs, there's a guest information form, and so if you can fill that out for us, let us know who you are and how we can be praying for you, and drop that in the boxes before you leave. Likewise, there's another area that you can put prayer requests. And so just note on there as you write your prayer request down if you want the whole church praying for you or just the elders of the church. And again, you can drop those in the boxes before you leave. Likewise, if you feel led to give today, you can either do that online or you can drop something in the boxes that are by the doors. Also, guests, we do have some packets up front that let you know a little bit more about who we are as a church and what we believe. Some of the men outside get those to you if you have not seen those and you want to know about our church. We do have a few things going on today after the service. We do have biblical counseling training at 2 o'clock for those who've been doing that. And today, I believe it's going to be the topic and the case study on marital counseling. And so some of you had mentioned that you are interested in learning more and more about that. And so that will be today, the case study for biblical counseling, 2 o'clock today. Also at 4:30, we have our new members class. Those who are going through new membership, meet today, 4:30 to 5:30. And then Bible study tonight at 6. Bible study tonight at 6. Lord willing, next Sunday, we will be doing some baptisms. And so if you are interested in baptism, come and talk with me about that after the service. We're hopefully, if you're not aware of how we do that here, we'll end up moving this stuff out of the way. And behind these doors here is actually our baptismal. We'll fill that up and do that at the start of the service next Sunday. So again, if you're interested, please come and talk with me this week about that. Next Sunday, do we know if we have play practice next Sunday?
Saturday.
Or Saturday, I mean? Next Saturday, 5 o'clock. Next Saturday, 5 o'clock, play practice for those who are going to be in the Christmas play. Let's see. The only other thing I have on here is thank you for everyone that helped out on Tuesday, Halloween for us. It was our Reformation Day celebration. We had games and candy, and I don't know, a couple hundred people came through, and it was a good time. Thank you for everyone who was able to serve hot chocolate, coffee, the games, candy. Thank you. It was a really good time. So I just want to make sure you're aware. We do have a library area over here, and so if you're a guest, make sure after the service you go over here and find Bibles or books that will help you understand about Christianity a little bit more. And if you do not have a Bible, grab one from there, and that's yours. All those books are a gift from us to you. If you can't find one over there that you like, grab one out of the pews, and you can just take one of those with you. Those are good Bibles as well. All right, any other announcements I'm missing? Yes, members meeting, thank you. Members meeting next Sunday. Instead of doing it directly after the service like we've been doing, we go right after the service and eat and then have a members meeting. We're actually going to have it Sunday night at normal 6 o'clock. So we normally would have a Bible study at 6. Next Sunday at 6 will be our members meeting. So please try to attend if you can. All right, that is all the announcements that I'm going to talk about. If there are any others, sorry, I missed them. You can talk with somebody afterwards. Debbie will help you. We're going to transition to our worship service now that the announcements are done. And what we normally do is we like to have an Old Testament reading, New Testament reading, but for the last few weeks we've been reading through Revelation chapters 2 and 3, the letters to the seven churches in the book of Revelation. All those churches were in what is known as modern day Turkey. And so as we've been going through these churches, what I want us to do is think about the way that Jesus is speaking to these churches, the things that he's encouraging them in. We need to hope that he would be encouraging us in those ways. And if he is, we praise God for that. There's also areas where he rebukes the churches. And so if this is a rebuke that we need to hear today as a church, then let us hear the rebuke. Let it sink deeply into our hearts and repent of any sin as a church that we would need to do. So if you're able and willing, please stand in honor of God's word. We're in chapter 3, book of Revelation, verses 1 through 6, the church in Sardis. And to the angel of the church in Sardis write, the words of him who has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know your works. You have the reputation of being alive, but you are dead. Wake up and strengthen what remains, and is about to die, for I have not found your works complete in the sight of my God. Remember then what you received and heard, keep it and repent. You will not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what hour I will come against you. Yet you have still a few names in Sardis, people who have not soiled their garments, and they will walk with me in white, for they are worthy. The one who conquers will be clothed thus in white garments, and I will never blot his name out of the book of life. I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Let me pray. Father, thank you for this word this morning. Lord, help us to wake up spiritually, wake up physically, and by your grace, strengthen what remains, Lord. May we be found complete and our works be found complete in your sight. Lord, help us to conquer by the blood of the Lamb. And Lord, we are thankful that those who trust in you, those who are clothed in white, you will never blot our name out of the book of life. So Lord, we ask that you be with us in our service today. We pray that the songs we sing would be encouraging to one another, lifting one another up, pointing us to Christ, and they would be honoring to you. Our prayers would be incense rising to you. Your word, when it is read and preached, Lord, that we would listen to it and be not only hearers but doers of the word, and you would use it to make us look more like Jesus. When we take the Lord's Supper, that we would see on display the gospel and Jesus' death for us. God, would you fill this place with your Spirit? Fill each one of us. And for those who do not know you today, we pray they would come to know you. Those who cannot be with us today, we pray that you would bless them and bring them back to us soon. But we love you and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Scripture says obedience is better than sacrifice. And the only way to be happy in Jesus is to trust and obey. So let's sing that together.
Grace also might reign through righteousness. leading to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Wonderful grace of our Lord. Let's sing it.
Jesus. Heavenly Father God, we thank you for your grace. Lord, we thank you for your mercy. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to gather together, Lord, to praise and worship you. Lord, we're thankful that you hear our prayers. Lord, we pray that you be with the unreached, Lord, not only this tide group, Lord, but all the unreached, Lord, in our nation, in our community, Lord. Lord, we pray for the missionaries. We pray for more to go forward and bring the good news of God, Lord. We pray for our church family, Lord, that we would be a light in our community. God, we pray that the remaining time of our praise and worship would honor and glorify you, Lord. Lord, remove distractions, remove thoughts, idols, Lord. Just help our focus to be on you and you alone. Lord, we pray for Pastor Billy, Lord, as he brings the message today, Lord. Help us to be not only hearers but doers of the word, Lord, that what we learn through you speaking through him, Lord. We pray that you be with him. Give us ears to hear and Lord, feet to apply. God, we love you because you first loved us, and we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you stand with us as we sing?
Worthy of every soul you have ever seen. Worthy of all the praise you could ever bring. Worthy of every breath you could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Jesus, the name of every other name. Jesus, the only one. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside.
Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his wounds we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned, everyone, to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all.
And he did it for us. Let's sing that together. All I have is Christ.
Hallelujah.
Copy of God's holy and inspired word and turn to Philippians chapter 1. Philippians chapter 1. That is in the New Testament. So if you take your Bible, open up about midway and then take that second half and then do the same thing, you'll be pretty close to Philippians. If you do not have a Bible today, there should be a pew Bible in front of you, and you should turn to page 980 or 981. It should be around there in the pew Bible. To songs that we sing there, especially the contemporary songs about building our lives on Christ, and then all that we have is Christ, fits well with the sermon text for the day today. We're going to read from 19 through 30, from 19 through 30. I might back up a little when I go to read, but I don't know quite yet if we're going to make it through all the verses of 19 through 30. It kind of depends on if you're falling asleep out there, or our time, or other factors. But the plan is to try to make it 19 through 30, but we'll see how it goes. Philippians chapter 1. For those who have not been with us, we are going through the letter here from the Apostle Paul to the church at Philippi. And this letter was written again to them, but for us. And he's writing this from prison, from jail, or house arrest, as some of you may have studied and seen what was going on there. But he's writing from prison to the church of Philippi. And that's actually not foreign to them because this church was really founded by Paul and Silas being in prison. And so there's a lot of prison going on when it comes to the Apostle Paul and when it comes to Christians. If you read your Bible carefully, and especially the New Testament, you will find that it is normal for Christians to be persecuted and it is normal for Christians to be put in prison. Hopefully it's for the gospel and not because we're doing things wrongly. But Paul, writing this letter about 10 years after he had started the church, and he's with Timothy, and he writes them, and right from the get-go, he thanks God for them. He thanks God for this church because of their partnership, which we talked about, the word would be fellowship, but it means more than just kind of hanging out. It's a commitment to one another. And so Paul thanks God for their commitment, their partnership, their fellowship in the gospel from the first day they became Christians all the way until now. It is normal for Christians to partner in the gospel. It is normal, even for new Christians in the New Testament, to, like, for example, give money so that the gospel would go forth. To be a Christian really is to be kingdom-minded. To think, how can we further God's kingdom on this earth? How can we evangelize more? How can we send more missionaries? How can we send more Bibles? How can we translate Bibles into the languages of the peoples? This is normal Christianity. After he gives thanks to God for the church at Philippi, he prays for them. And he prays that their love would grow more and more for one another, and more for God, and more for the lost. He prays that that love would come with knowledge and all discernment. There are many people out there who say that they are very loving. And you'll often hear people say that God is love. Is that true? Is God love? Yes. Is God only love? No. He is holy and just and many other things. There are many people out there who try to love others, but it's not with true knowledge and discernment. It's not in line with what God's Word says, what love is. The Apostle Paul is confident for the church at Philippi. Because he has seen them grow, he's seen them suffer for the sake of the gospel, he's confident that Jesus, who began this good work in them, in justification, will see it all the way through to glorification. Jesus will do that, and Paul is thankful because he sees the evidence, the fruit of righteousness, the fruit in their lives. They're actually really Christians. Churches today are peppered throughout with people who think that they're Christians, but they're really not. And the Apostle Paul says, I'm so thankful when I look at you because I see the fruit of righteousness, the fruit, the work of the Holy Spirit of God. You are a new creation, and I can see that. And so Paul says, he who began it will see it unto completion. But there were apparently some of the church who were struggling a little bit because they were worried that the gospel was going to stop going forth for some reason. Well, Paul's in prison, so this is actually really, really bad. And so Paul reassures them that what's happened to him has really actually served to advance the gospel. By Paul being in prison, by the way Paul suffers, by his testimony, by the things that he says, by the things that he does, the type of prisoner that he is, it actually advances the gospel so that everybody knew that the reason Paul was in prison was for Christ. We talked about if people looked at your life, if they looked at the way you suffer, the way you go through trials, the way you go through hardships, would they see Christ? Would they see that you suffer well and point them to Christ? Or would they not? There were even some who were going around and they were actually preaching the true gospel, but they were doing it for the wrong reasons. And they were actually trying to get Paul in more trouble, make it more difficult on Paul. And Paul says, you know what? I don't even care. They can preach the gospel, and if they're doing it for bad motives or good motives, he says, I don't even care because Christ is proclaimed. As long as he's proclaimed, then I rejoice. And that's where we ended our time last time, with Paul rejoicing that the gospel is being preached no matter what. And so he continues on with his letter. Follow along with me, beginning in 18, the second half of verse 18 of chapter 1. Yes, and I will rejoice, the Apostle Paul says. For I know that through your prayers and the help of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, this will turn out for my deliverance. As it is my eager expectation and hope that I will not be at all ashamed, but that with full courage now, as always, Christ will be honored in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me. Yet which I shall choose, I cannot tell. I am hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ. But that is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary on your account. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with you all for your progress and joy in the faith, so that in me you may have ample cause to glory in Christ Jesus because of my coming to you again. Only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent, I may hear of you that you are standing firm in one spirit and one mind, striving side by side for the faith of the gospel. Verse 28, and not frightened in anything by your opponents. This is a clear sign to them of their destruction, but of your salvation, and that from God. For it has been granted to you that for the sake of Christ, you should not only believe in him, but also suffer for his sake. Engaged in the same conflict that you saw I had, and now hear that I still have. The Apostle Paul says he's rejoicing. Back up to verse 19, he says, I know that through your prayers and the help of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, this will turn out for my deliverance. He could mean just being delivered from prison. He's in prison again and under trial. And he could mean that, but it seems that he means more than that. That his deliverance, his salvation, he knows that whichever way this thing goes, he is ultimately going to be delivered. Whether he's put to death or he's let go, does not matter. Ultimately, he will be delivered over to Christ himself. But it may mean that Paul had some insight, some understanding from God that he was going to be released here. But notice what he says here. It's through the help of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, but it also is through their what? What's the word?
Prayers.
Their prayers. you pray like it matters? Like, are you the type of person that prays like it really does matter? Like, do you believe in prayer? That when we pray and in a strange mystery, the hand of God moves. Many times we see that we have not, because the scriptures tell us we ask not. And sometimes it seems like a formality when we pray. Well, we're supposed to pray, especially if somebody's sick or something's going on. But do you labor in prayer on behalf of others, on behalf of the lost, on behalf of these little ones that they would come to faith, on those who are sick? Do you pray for your brothers and sisters in Christ? We have the prayer updates that go out throughout the week. Do you pray like it really matters? That God will respond. And so Paul, in an amazing statement here, says it's both. It's the Spirit of God, the Spirit of Jesus Christ working, and the means that God chooses to use is the prayers of the saints of Philippi. Some of the great work that God is doing in this church and in some of you are a direct result of prayers of many of you in here. In fact, I've seen this said a few times, that there are some of you, even this morning, you are sitting in these pews because other people around you have been praying for you. They have been laboring for you on your behalf in tears, asking for favor from God in your life, that you would respond. And Paul knows that because of the work of Jesus, because of the prayers of the church at Philippi, he will be delivered ultimately for salvation. But he seems to have some idea that it looks like he's going to be released from prison as well. But he doesn't state it as a fact. God can still do whatever God's going to do. Because he says in verse 20, "As it is my eager expectation and hope that I will not be at all ashamed, but that with full courage, now as always, Christ will be honored in my body, whether by my life or my death." So there's that kind of that idea of, is he just talking about getting out of prison there, or does he mean overall, no matter what? He says, I'm not going to be put to shame because he's put his hope in Christ. This idea of shame comes up in Paul's writing multiple times in some of his other letters. It's kind of when you think about it to the church of Corinth when he's writing, and he talks about the resurrection. And what he says is actually, if the resurrection isn't a real thing, then we as Christians should be pitied among all people the most. Why does he say that? Well, ultimately, it means that you should be living your life in such a way, sacrificing for the kingdom in such a way, that it's like you're wasting your life if there's no resurrection. If Christianity's not real, then you should be wasting your life, basically. Or you are wasting your life. That's what he's saying. But then, of course, he says, but the resurrection is real. But if it's not real, then we should be pitied most. Do you live your life that way? Like, if Christianity's not real, does it really matter? Does it look that different for you? Are you living for the kingdom in such a way that it's like, man, that person is really putting all their money in that pot? All their bets, if you will, are going toward that Jesus is real. Or are you kind of on the fence? Yeah, I'm following Jesus, but I'm also kind of doing other things as well. Are you all in for Jesus? Paul's like, man, I'm all in. I will not be ashamed because Christ is real. On that day, you know, Paul's in prison right now. That's kind of a shameful thing. He's been in prison multiple times. He gets beaten. All kinds of things happen. That seems shameful unless he's being beaten and put in prison for the truth. And what Paul's saying is, guess what? There's a day coming. There's a day coming where it's going to be revealed that I suffered for the right thing. All those people who were beating me, they were scolding me, they put me in prison, all these things, he goes, there's a day coming for them where they're going to find out that it's Christ and Christ alone that we're saved. It's Christ who is King, and they will bow the knee. And on that day, I will not be ashamed. so I'm not going to be ashamed now. As always, Christ will be honored in my body, whether by life or by death. What do you use your life for, beloved? Is Christ central to you? He goes on, look what he says. Whether by life or death, verse 21, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. It's such a great bumper sticker. Such a great thing to put on a coffee cup. Maybe get a tattoo if you're into that. Following that? I spent all week just trying to think on what does it mean for me to live is Christ. I mean, we get the die is gain part. What he means is, of course, there is that you get to go be with Jesus. That should be better than everything else. And there is a side that we need to ask ourselves that question. If you really had the choice, leave this life now and go be with Jesus, what would you choose? Do you love this world so much that you don't want to leave to go be with Jesus? Do you love it here so much? Do you think so little of Jesus that you just want to enjoy the blessings he's given you and not him himself? The Apostle Paul, he says in 22, right? He says, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me. Yet which I shall choose, I cannot tell. Now don't get for a second, you're like, Paul, it gets to decide whether or not he's going to die or not. That's not what that means. It's one of two things. It's either like, just kind of hypothetical, he's just like, wow, which one would I choose? If right now I get the choice to go or stay, which one? Oh, I'm hard pressed. And or, he's meaning, what was he praying for? He's in prison. Is he praying, God, take me now? Or should I be praying, God, leave me because there's fruitful work for me to do? I'm hard-pressed, verse 23, between the two. My desire to depart and be with Christ. Well, that is far better. That's my true desire, Paul says. But, verse 24, to remain in the flesh is more necessary on your account, the church of Philippi. I really want to go be with Jesus, but I need to stay around here for you guys. He says, convinced of this, 25, I know that I will remain and continue with you all for your progress and joy in the faith. He said, I know that the Lord is going to keep me here because it's not time for me to go because you need me longer, Paul says. But as you go back, think about that. The living, for me to live, back 21, for to me to live is Christ. What he says about that, what he explains in those following verses is fruitful labor. So that's what you have to ask yourself. If you right now are like, oh man, for me to live is Christ. What do you mean? Do you mean what Paul means? Do you mean fruitful labor? How about, let's put it this way. If you die right now, does it make a difference in people's lives? Spiritually. Yeah, your family loves you and that sort of thing. I'm talking about spiritual. I'm talking about kingdom wise. Are you like following Jesus in such a way? Is everything so centered, the gospel centered, and everything you're thinking, everything that you're doing, your whole life revolves around Jesus so much that if you died right now, man, the impact would be huge, spiritually speaking. The way you're serving others, discipling, who are you pouring into, right? Paul's like, I got to stay around because you guys need to keep growing. I need to help you. Who are you discipling, friends? Does it make a difference at all if you die right now other than people miss you? Does it make a difference in the church? Do you serve at all in the church? In any way, or literally, if you died, we just wouldn't even know. Wouldn't affect us at all, would that be true? Well, of course not. Hopefully we have a body of Christ here where we love one another and notice one another and pour out our gifts for one another. The gifts that God's given us to build up the church. But as you chew on, what does it mean to live as Christ? And would you say that's really true of your life? And now you know what? For many of you, I think you are. I think for many of you, you are living for Christ. You're doing your best to try to follow him faithfully. And some of you, I think, are on the fence on that. You're like, I want that, but sometimes I don't. I think that's a normal battle. But what are you committed to? For Paul, he is committed to living for Christ. fruitful labor. So he says, I need to stick around for you guys so that I can continue along with you for your progress and joy in the faith. That's again what we should be doing, coming alongside one another to help each other progress in the faith. So that, verse 26, in me you may have ample cause to glory in Christ Jesus because of my coming to you again. Paul says, I got to stick around and I'm going to come visit you again. And when I do, you are going to rejoice and give God the glory because I've come back to spend time with you. And there again is this great love that they have for one another. He says, so I'm certain that I'm coming back to you, but here's what you need to do in the meantime. Verse 27, only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Christ. Live in such a way that matches the gospel. Live in such a way as people, as they learn about Jesus, as they see what Jesus has done, and then they look at your life, they don't go, wait a minute, that doesn't match up at all. That doesn't match up. Don't live that way. Live in such a way that they're like, you know what? You're one of those little Jesus followers, aren't you? Do you know the term Christian? It wasn't originally used as like a good thing. That term is really more of a you little Jesus followers. Little Jesuses. Look at you. You want to be like Jesus. Well, yeah. Little Christs. When people see that in us. So Paul says, hey, I'm going to come to you. I know. I'd rather go be with God. I'd rather be with Jesus. But I'm supposed to come to you to help you along. So until I come, live your lives in a manner worthy of the gospel. So whether I'm there or I'm far away from you, I can hear that you're standing firm. Now look what this means to live as a follower of Jesus. Look at these things. In verse 27, you're to stand firm in one spirit, with one mind, striving side by side for the faith of the gospel. Do you see the unity that he's talking about here? He says, church, what it means to really follow is that you are going to be side by side, one spirit, one mind, one mission. We're moving forward together. The Apostle Paul says that this is what it means to live a life worthy of the gospel. Because it's the glorious gospel that actually unites us together. Different tribes, tongues, nations. Different socioeconomical groups. Different classes. Doesn't matter. The gospel unites. And because the gospel unites, we should live in such a way that we are side by side, striving after the main goal together. And then what happens? Is that supernatural unity? Here's what happens. Verse 28. We wouldn't be frightened in anything by our opponents. This is a clear sign to them. Those who oppose Christianity, when they see the church, when they see the church is unified, we're loving one another, we're trying to accomplish the same gospel, the same mission. When they see that, here's what it is. It's a sign to them of their destruction. The enemies of God, when they see that unity, whatever this means exactly, it's a sign to them. You will be destroyed. You are going against God because God is working in an incredible way among His church. Look at the unity. It's a sign to them for their destruction, but to you Christians, it's a sign for your salvation. Isn't that remarkable? The unity of the church, the unity of the gospel, the fact that Jesus dies for all peoples, tribes, tongues, nations, doesn't matter, and He brings us together, is a sign to them for their destruction and is a sign of salvation for us. How do you know if a church is spirit-filled? How do you know if a church is spirit-filled? Some would say, well, they have to have their hands raised during worship. Some would say they have to be maybe perhaps speaking in tongues or having some other spiritual gifts happening. Some would say if you have young families, then you have the Holy Spirit there. Some would say, no, if you have older people, you have the Holy Spirit. Some would say if you have a bunch of different people from different ethnic backgrounds, that's really a church that has a spirit. It's unity. It's love. And unity, true unity, is how you know that a church has the Spirit of God. Because that is hard. To be loving and unified and not divided all the time, that's really hard. Especially when we come from different backgrounds, different perspectives. To be unified like that, that's a sign that the Spirit of God is among you. And that you are saved. Let me end with this. Notice he says it's again, it's a sign for their destruction, but it's a sign of your salvation. And that is from God. God. Now watch this. Let this verse blow your socks off for a second. For it has been granted to you. Who does the granting? God does the granting. Look what you've been granted, believer. For it has been granted to you that for the sake of Christ, now that is really actually something in the Bible, when we say Christ's sake, many people say it, wrong context. For the glory of Christ, for the name of Christ, you, believer, it has been granted to you by God for Christ's sake that you should not only believe in Him, but you should also suffer for His sake. Who does the granting? God. What are the two things you get granted by God? He grants you belief and suffering. And those two things work together for Christ's sake. And that is from God. And so as he ends, he says, it has been granted to you, Church of Philippi in particular, to go through persecution, engage in the same conflict that you saw I had, Paul says, and now you hear that I still have. Believer, you should be excited today. God has granted you belief and you get to suffer for his name. You don't look as happy about the second one. I'm just being honest. I'm kind of reading the room. You know what I'm saying? Like, you're granted belief. You're like, amen. Thank you, Jesus. And then suffer for his name. The way you know Christ is in his patience. And he perseveres you. God uses that to make you look more like Jesus, to strengthen your faith. And as your faith grows, you become more and more unified. And as that happens, then you can finally say, for me to live is Christ. But man, to die would be gain. But guess what? You're still here. None of you have keeled over during my sermon yet. You've got fruitful work to do. Don't waste it. If we're still here, then we have fruitful labor. Let's keep going. Father, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy and your love. We are thankful, Lord, that you have granted to us, it has come from you, that we would believe and suffer. But it's also come from Christ through his prayer, his high priestly prayer, that we as Christians, we as a church, would be unified. And that this would be a testimony to the world of our salvation and even of their destruction. Because for us to be unified around the gospel is supernatural. And it means Jesus really has come from God. So Lord, help us to understand these things deeper. Lord, help us to love deeper. Help us to be unified. Help us to share this message. Help us to be a people who really can say, for us to live is Christ. Everything about our lives centered on the gospel and the kingdom. But help us to not love this world so much that we want to hang on to it, that we would really view dying as gain to go and be with Jesus. We thank you for him in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Now, Brother Mike, come forward. He's one of our deacons. He's going to help the Lord's Supper. Jeff, one of our deacons, has come forward as well. And Brother Jamie, one of our elders, is going to help during this time. We're going to prepare the Lord's Supper for you up here. This is for those who are baptized followers of Jesus. And even if you're not a member of this church, but you're a baptized follower of Jesus, then you are welcome to take the Lord's Supper. And this is a proclamation. We're doing this to remember Jesus and to proclaim him. So we're doing that through our singing, through our prayers, through our preaching, and through the Lord's Supper. And so if you're not a follower of Jesus yet, then just what you'll do during this time is you'll just sit and you'll just observe what we're doing here. But for all of us, this is a time to respond to the things that you've been singing and hearing. And so take a few moments now, ask God to search your heart while we prepare things up here for you, okay? Go ahead and do that now.
as they were eating, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them and said, take it, this is my body. Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank from it. He said to them, this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will no longer drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God.
We're going to start on the wings, and as you guys come forward, if you're waiting for your turn, okay, you go and then you sit back down, or while you're waiting, feel free to read scripture of the congregation as we come forward during this time. Go ahead and start over here. If you're not able to get up, we can bring it to you here shortly.
Our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Go ahead and stand with the response.
Sing with us.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen. Have a blessed day, everybody.
I'm all right.